I've always thought that it would be great if art was sold in shopping centers, just like, you know, clothes and ceramics and household goods and toasters and appliances, because there would be a kind of taking away of this mystique of, you know, knowing how to behave and knowing how to dress and going into the gallery and going to the openings and getting the little invitations. The reason that it's so much easier to buy clothes or, you know, ceramics or lamps or sofas than it is to buy paintings or prints or sculptures or videos, non-commercial videos, is that we learn through the marketplace to make discriminations and choices, and we learn, therefore, to trust our own taste.
Welcome in the Singer Museum.
It's like, you know, a boy toy.
But everyone is jealous.
Everyone is jealous.
No,
I'm
no?
not jealous.
No.
I'm not really jealous.
The only camera is.
Is it? Yeah. I don't even take pictures at all.
No.
Yeah. I don't even have a camera.
No?
The Sara Lee collection is a collection which really begins with Impressionism at the very start of the movement. Monet's portrait of his little boy on a mechanical horse was painted in 1872, which was just 2 years before the first Impressionist exhibition. It was extraordinary. No building like it in the world. Corbusier rushed up here.
Yeah, he
could not go through a week. The theory of it is that it's that manufacturing theory that works by gravity, and the thing moves down, and when it's done and packaged at the bottom, and it ships out. And so, and of course, no manufacturing is done like that anymore. It's all horizontal. This is the executive office building, and the boardroom was down there. You went through this and down this staircase, and then this long corridor takes you all the way to the end of the building.
It was sacred land. The hills and the waterfalls and the volcanoes or the mountains, the grass, the trees, it was all sacred. The pre-Hispanic people had wonderful pyramids and temples and so on, upon which the Spanish built churches. So the sacredness of that space continued to be sacred.
Sacred Space is a project which is probably the most important and concerted attempt to document the sacred
in Central America ever made by anyone. And the fact that one photographer with one sensibility over a discrete period of time with a kind of assignment in her mind, which is to find something that's invisible, the sacred, in architecture and nature, is something that was Carolyn's assignment, and she took it on with gusto. You're going to places that are inflected by man in natural forms, and where people come and gather out of doors in the main, in nature, to be filled with the sacred. So what we decided to do was to make an exhibition in what amounted to the sacred space itself, to make a connection between ceremonial architecture and the most important ceremonial architecture in Dallas, which is Fair Park, and to make a link between walking down that esplanade and seeing the fountains and water and going into the axial space and seeing something that was decorated with painting and sculpture.
Well, it's a ceremonial space. The State Fair every year, that's a big ceremony. And it, in a way, it's as religious, it has a religious feeling to it.
Given the fact that the fastest growing part of our population is the Hispanic and principally Mexican part of our population, given the fact that we now have free trade with Mexico, given the fact that one of our six flags was Mexico and another of our six flags was Spain, so we're linked twice to this much larger cultural landscape, and so why not celebrate it? Why not celebrate it through an exhibition that sort of serves to indicate that there is an extraordinary cultural depth to that landscape, not just economic associations and people associations, but cultural associations. One of the great dramas in the history of modern art is the whole interplay between painting and photography. And photography was announced to the world in 1839 in the Chamber of Deputies in Paris. And it was announced as the new way of seeing. And Lady Eastlake, the wife of the director of the National Gallery in London, said by the next year that from today, painting is dead. And there was, as a result of that, this idea that painting and photography were not just different from each other, but competed with each other. And very few artists took on the sort of nexus of that competition as much as the American painter and photographer Charles Scheeler. Scheeler made photographs, and Scheeler made a few drawings, which when you walk into a room and you see them on the other side of the room, you would swear that they were photographs. You have no idea that they're made by hand. And of course, the notion that if it's made by a machine, it's more objective, and if it's made by hand, it's truer. Those two things were in a kind of battle in the late 19th and early 20th century. And Scheeler made something because he knew so much about photographs, because he made photographs. He made a drawing which you would swear was a photograph, and yet when you get within maybe 3 feet of it, you know that it's not. And then you question the whole meaning of what is made by hand and what is made by machine. And if of all of the photographic drawings by Scheeler, this is probably the greatest and the one that requires the smallest distance between the viewer and it before you know that it's a drawing. Sears Roebuck built this unprecedentedly large building in Dallas because, of course, it's corporate headquarters at that time was Chicago, and Chicago has this terrible thing called winter. And so they built the headquarters for the catalog business in Dallas. And through the warehouse was a railroad line with two trains going each direction. And so there's a kind of curved street that runs through this gigantic building. And on that curved street are a series of irregularly shaped lofts, which are the lofts of the artists of the UTD Southside residency program.
Read only that without extreme magnification or auditory aids, I do not read text. The most difficult task is writing itself scribbling.
It's this weird, odd, little outpost from downtown, but sort of downtown's sort of there, glistening. Southside has such great space that you just want to investigate just all of the architecture of the building, walking around it, all the great, you know, places that give you a little bit of place to roam in one's imagination.
Okay, there's poems for all the people that are outside that are too cool to come out and see the poetry.
One of the great things about Southside is that because it's an early 20th century industrial building, it has lots of big spaces. And Sears, which, you know, used to own Southside, was the largest casket manufacturer in the world. That factory is this beautiful room, one of the most beautiful rooms in Dallas. And during the residency of UTD Southside, we have done a lot. And Southside has also done a lot on its own, so that there are performances. And there's a kind of energy. This program, in the 2 years of its activity, has really profoundly changed Dallas. It's brought artists from every continent to the city. It's brought mid-career and young artists. And it's done so in the context of a really avant-garde urban community. What the artist residency does is that it recognizes that we produce rather than just consume culture. We can collect great contemporary art, but until we begin to produce great contemporary art at the level at which we collect, we will always be doomed to being provincial. And I think that Southside has the opportunity and the occasion to really transform the city of Dallas in a very important way. I mean, we're sitting in a shop, and a shop means working with the metal and glass and tools and all of that. He's an overeducated manual laborer at this point in our story. You know, what's amazing is how essentially primitive all of the tools are.
Well, these are primitive tools. This is not a machine shop. There's no computers.
Yeah. When Jim and I did the show together at the Mac, the great pieces, the Jim McGee pieces, the heavy pieces were on the wall as they were, and then there were these. Jim made these two great big cases with a lot of his notebooks, and they're notebook after notebook after notebook after notebook that are both texts and sort of diary entries and stories and cuttings and drawings and this, that, and the other thing. And what they are is a kind of unfolding process of forming a narrative and finding connections between the narrative and certain kinds of objects around him, made of whatever they are. And what they make possible is a sort of condition of the mind and body in which you can box or contain a narrative or a story. And that's what these things are. They're not just constructions that are designed to be attractive. They have this whole hinge
to stories, and to stories that are sometimes mythic and sometimes personal and sometimes memories. And that's the beauty of the titles.
Today is paradise overcast.
The titles sort of spew out from the pieces the preparation that resulted in them.
Okay. This is the title for this pack of steel.
Okay.
I must remember the title for the pack of steel. The title is By One, a Boy Sucks His Thumb. Soon 10 years gone, 5 years done. A man handles what he can, beast of meat, cock in hand.
The thing that's interesting to say is that the works of art by Jim McGee in the shop are like sketches or parts of this larger, gigantic, unfinished work of art, which is called The Hill, and which is always evolving and in a state of planning, and in ways that these make it is easy to complete these things because they're finite and because they're small and because they don't move so much as the pieces within the buildings in The Hill. But they make it possible both to study particular conditions in The Hill and to finish something. Because, of course, the great work is this gigantic work in process. And there are 4 buildings at The Hill, and 3 of them are finished. And one of them will forever be unfinished.
We all know the name Dijon because of mustard, and we all know the name Burgundy because of wine. But Dijon was the royal capital of the Dukes of Burgundy and of a domain which was as large as present-day France. And when you walk into the city down the old streets, you feel almost as if you're going back into the late Middle Ages. And when you look up at the great tower of the incredible royal palace of the Dukes of Burgundy, you'll get a sense of a building that was in many senses as important as was the Louvre when it was the royal palace of the kings of France. One never forgets seeing them for the first time. They're amongst the most powerful and celebratory works of art about death. Not that they celebrate death, but their pageantry and the extraordinary quality of the angels and the lifelikeness of the figures on the top of the tombs are amazing. But the most amazing thing about the tombs were the groups of mourners around both the tombs. What you see is the eternalization of a procession. And that's why the figures appear to be moving as they processed before the body of the Duke of Burgundy. They have these enormous cowls, these huge pieces of heavy drapery that go over their heads, and some of them reveal their heads, some of them cover their heads so you can see their faces, some of them cover even their faces and look down at their feet as they move, and you have to imagine their faces. Some of them reveal their hands and hold books as if they're singing or speaking, and it is the sense of them kind of swaying as they move along in a procession that is eternalized in alabaster and miniaturized as they're placed around the tombs.
We now are creating an institute of art history, the first one in the early 21st century, the first one in the center of the United States, and the first one in the digital era.
The Edith O'Donnell Institute of Art History started out as a result of a challenge from Mrs. O'Donnell, who has believed in the arts and the visual arts as an essential part of any successful modern society. And she has spent so much of her life thinking about the exposure of young people to the arts. One of the things that she had never really done was to think about the future of art history, of this discipline in which she majored at the University of Texas at Austin.
I learned art history like few have. I took every art history course they offered. I think it broadens your life. It just makes you more aware of your surroundings and your opportunities too.
And she asked me to think about what she called art history UTD style. It was the O'Donnells who challenged us to be more ambitious than we were accustomed to being, rather than us asking for more money. They asked us to be more ambitious. And so we're a kind of little, nimble, funnily placed institute in the context of these very big and rather grand and traditional institutes. We have in the DFW Metroplex over 100 PhD art historians. One of the things that we did a few years ago was to make an organization of those scattered art historians. And this was something that Mrs. O'Donnell was really interested in, because rather than creating a whole new thing and bringing all these people to Dallas and saying, well, we're now as good as any place else, we had elected to use what was already here and to serve as a kind of a gathering point. The second alliance that we've made through the Institute is with the Dallas Museum of Art to bring their PhD curators, of which there are many, into the fold as people who will teach our students, both in the museum and at the university, and allow our academic art historians access to the realms of the curator.
What's made all of this really come to focus in the arts is the Edith O'Donnell ATEC, Arts and Technology Building at UT Dallas, which was designed by an architect who also designed the Google headquarters. And this building has the kind of frantic, almost manic energy of the Google headquarters, and it's going to be the UTD home of the Edith O'Donnell Institute of Art History.
What I wanted to do is to bring the most creative architects in the area to bear on the issue of how you study art and how you work together and what the relationship now is between the digital world and the world of books. Corky Cunningham's place is full of diagonals and all sorts of energy, and it's like it's very juicy and full of life. And Russ Buchanan's is very straight and severe and rigid in a certain way, and about light and space and order. I love the idea of institute because it's not precious, and it also suggests something beyond the university. That the real audience for the Institute is not just the undergraduates and graduate students at UTD, but are the people of North Texas and of this region. Jay and Ruthie Pack have been married a long time and lived in this wonderful house. I got a call from a friend in New York, from Joaquin Pizarro, and a dealer friend who had to sell a really great Cezanne, which I had known for most of my professional life as being in this private collection in San Francisco. And I'd actually gone to see it and met its previous owner, Mrs. Albert. And it needed to be in this exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art. And it couldn't be on the market. If it was in this exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art, it had to be owned by somebody so that the museum wasn't accused of being a dealer. And so I called Jay, not knowing what he would think. And Jay and Ruthie thought about it and looked at the work of art and decided that it would be wonderful as their first acquisition. Cezanne's paintings really have no titles, ever. I mean, they're the titles that are given to paintings are given to paintings by dealers in the main, and he didn't even think about titles when he's painting his paintings. But it's a painting that was made in 1877 in the spring, so we know actually when it was painted, which is rare also for a Cezanne. And it was painted when he was in his sort of long, almost decade-long apprenticeship with the older Impressionist painter, Camille Pizarro, who was a sort of father figure to him. And what's interesting about it is that it's very, very pictorially complex. And all of it is alive. I mean, the sky is, he's kind of cropped the sky so that there's very little recession. You look at this kind of architectural combination of buildings on the hillside, which is almost cubist, and then the relationship between these solid masses and which are varied in the way that they relate to the hillside and the vegetation and the planes of the vegetation, the trees in the front and the trees in the middle ground and the trees in the distance, and this kind of glowering, rainy day. And then the wonderful, sort of implacable, flat landscape of the agricultural plain down below. You see, what you do in these agricultural villages is you live on the hill because you can't grow anything on the hill. And you leave as much flat land as you can for agriculture because that's where it grows best and that's where the rain goes and all of that. So you have all these vertiginous houses on the hill, and if you look at this painting, you can go like that to Cubism at Estac and the early pictures in the south of France where these cubic buildings kind of laminate the hillsides in ways which are more geometric than this, but this leads directly to it. What's fun about being in the house is that you've got this big stack of books underneath the painting, and most of the big stack of books is written by me. So there's this kind of learning experience that, and Jay and Ruthie read all these books, or at least claim to. I'm sort of hoping that they actually do. And also that we've gone together to visit the site, because the site today is not really all that much different than it was in 1877. And I knew where it was, and so we all, the first time they went there on their own, and they had a car and driver, and I was in the cell phone in the United States, and the car and driver is in Pontoise, and I'm trying to get them to this garden. It was really funny. And finally, there's this aha moment when you finally find this particular site in a completely unremarkable landscape. And they learned a lot about how to make great art out of unremarkable places. And it's really fun to stand someplace where the artist who painted the painting in your living room stood. you know, and look at this landscape and sort of think about the significance of it as a landscape, and, you know, how you would respond to it in ways that are kind of dictated by the work of art. Suddenly, what happened in the house is that this painting arrived and it was on the wall, and it almost begged them to buy companions for it. So we started this adventure of looking at works of art and getting to know each other better and traveling and reading books and looking at things and going to sales and meeting dealers and this, that, and the other thing. And Jay is a very, very serious and very good businessman, and is really knows a lot more than I do about negotiating and money and what you can get for what and all of that, whereas all I really care about is whether it's a great work of art. I don't really care about what it's worth. And Ruthie became an advocate of my side of the of the aesthetic side of the thing. And so we started as a kind of threesome, kind of middle-aged art advisor who works for no money, and two wonderful collectors who had somehow stretched and bought something really great and suddenly wanted to have other wonderful works of art that surrounded it. And so that started the collection. And it was about a 4 or 5 year period, a pretty active buying before there were no walls left in the house. You can ask me anything you want, of course.
I'll just spring it on you. It's easy.
Okay.
Why is this museum important?
One of the great tragedies of American art and American art history in the last generation and a half, last two generations, is that since World War II, the United States has become a global place, a place that's really interested in larger and non-regional issues. During the Depression in the 1930s, we hunkered down and were really interested in producing art for regions and thinking about how art could relate to where we are. And that disappeared in the 1960s and 1970s, both in museum collections, in exhibitions, in art history. There has, in fact, never been a university course at any university in Texas in the last 30 years devoted to art produced in Texas. Texas has 3 of the 10 largest cities in the world. We have major institutions, educational institutions and art schools who have produced thousands of artists, many of whom stay in the state and many of whom leave and take their roots, their Texas roots elsewhere, to New York, to LA, to Europe. And contribute to the larger discourse of art history. There is not one state in the United States that has its own statewide art museum. And given the fact that Texas is the largest state in the lower 48, has its own almost kind of national agenda, has this sense in which it wants to be itself, and it wants to be part of the world at the same time, it should be the first place where there is a museum of regional art that isn't provincial, that's about really the possibilities of art making in an urban context, fundamentally urban context, throughout the state. Our state now is so complex in terms of immigration from all over the world, in terms of south of the border immigration, in terms of the residue of our history of slavery. All of these things kind of come together to create a truly complex world, and each part of those worlds produces art, and produces art that tells us something about the state. And I think it will be, I know that this museum will break ground nationally and internationally. The only museum that I know, actually, in the world that does this successfully is the National Museum of Singapore, which opened just about 3 or 4 years ago, and which is devoted to the ways in which the arts deal with the fraught notions of identity in a modern nation state, a modern sort of city state. And it's fabulous museum, and it has taught Singaporeans a good deal about themselves and each other. It also is located in old buildings, buildings that have been repurposed and brought to life in order to bring art that was produced since the beginning of the city-state of Singapore to the present that raise questions about what it means to be from that place. It is not provincial to raise questions about where you are and where you live, and the effects of where you are and where you live on what you do and what you make. And that is what a great museum can do. It can bring Texas back into art and create a situation in which all of the art scattered through the museum collections of the state can have a home in one place. All the private collections and the groups of people who've been studying and collecting Texas art have a place where they can contribute, a place where all the people who collect books and pamphlets and historical information about the state can produce a library, a place where you can question what you learn from works of art, how works of art affect you, where they come from, and what they do in a region that is so fabulous and so complex and so mythic that it truly deserves its own museum.